We thank you for joining us today for worship, and we pray that God will speak to your heart as you worship with us this day. Stuart will get us started with a few announcements.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome. Next week is the first Sunday of the month, which means we will have communion. Remember to get your juice and bread ahead of time. This is also when we do our food drive for Valley View Food Bank and Heart Pantry. We will be doing a special drive for both of these on July 9th from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. here in the parking lot of the church. If you cannot go shopping, you can always donate money. You can go online to our new link or make a checkout to the church. Just be sure to write a note of who the donation is for. The foundation approved Sessions' request for funding of the live streaming equipment in Swain Hall. Tom gave a good explanation of live streaming in an email, and Beth did one going out in the spire.
Let me add one other bit to Stuart's announcement about the live streaming. We are aware that there may be some people who are watching this that have not been a part of our church family, but we are looking for some people who will help us volunteer with the live streaming to help with the filming of that on Sunday mornings when we get back together. So if you are you person who's watching this and have an interest and ability with that, please let us know. We'd love to get you involved in helping us with that. My friend Bruce Byrne points out, God invites us to worship that we might enjoy the intimacy, the love, and the joy that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit have enjoyed together for eternity. He created us in such a way that our deepest needs would be met in worship. But as thirst is quenched in the presence of water, not by focusing on our thirst, but by drinking, our needs are met in worship. Not by focusing on our needs, but on God himself. In worship, it is not God's needs that are being met, as if God created us to worship him due to a lack of self-esteem on God's part. Rather, God delights when we worship him because we need him. And in worship, true worship, we enjoy him as he intends. God delights in our worship because he delights in sharing himself with us. As you prepare your heart for worship this day, reflect upon what it means for you to turn your attention to God and to drink in of his blessings to your life.
Good morning, fellow virus fighters. Please join me in our opening prayer. Almighty God, we stand amazed over the miracle we celebrate each Sunday. Not just that you rose from the grave, overcoming the power of death, but that you love us enough to have died upon a cross for us, carrying in your soul our sins and sorrows. What a powerful and loving Savior you are. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Amen. Please join me in singing our hymn of thanksgiving. You can sing as loud as you want, on key or off key, as no one will hear you. Our hymn of thanksgiving, Now Thank We All Our God.
I want to thank Gary Kapp for serving as our liturgist today. This is Gary's first time of helping us out in that way, and I appreciate your willingness to come and help us with that, Gary. We have the joy this morning of interviewing Bill Gleason, our choir director and our special singer for today. So I want to invite Bill to come forward. Bill, you are the choir director at this church, and you are arranging the special music during this time that the choir cannot sing. And thank you for doing that. You also teach music in the schools. Tell us about how you got started in music.
Well, I sang in choir at a Catholic school, elementary school, and when we graduated, they made a class prophecy, and mine was that I was going to be a choir director. And it was at our first mixed dance, and I cried because I didn't want to be known as a choir person. I thought I was an athlete. And I sang in high school, and when I got to college, I found out what great music was like. I had a director that inspired me, and I changed my major from history to music, and I've been conducting ever since.
So what do you enjoy most about your work with music?
I think because I teach such a wide age gap, I used to say 8 to 80, but since I'm in this church, I expand it now from maybe 5 to 90. When I'm working with the children, I really enjoy their enthusiasm. I feel a great privilege to be shaping their musical future. I want to teach them how to sing, how to appreciate and listen to music, and become lifelong learners in music. When I work with adults, it's really a different feeling of accomplishment when we can put the words and the poetry and the music together in just the right way, and you see the smiles on the faces, and you hear the growth from the first rehearsal to the performance. It just brought me to tears many times and smiles many more times. I just enjoy conducting and working with people.
Thank you. What are some things you enjoy away from music?
I used to play a lot of sports. Now I'm more of a watcher, but I do enjoy them. I enjoy camping, and so now I can't go camping with the fires. I can't watch sports. I'm kind of bored. And lately I've become a fantasy football fanatic, and my wife's not too fond of that, but she puts up with it.
And I know you've been walking every morning, about 5 miles a day. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I've heard about the COVID-15, and I'm usually pretty active when I'm teaching. I never get to sit down, and rather than sit around, I really wanted to be proactive and see if I could get my heart rate up and stay healthy.
Great. People at our church know you mostly from your back as you direct the choir, but what is something that you might like people to know about you that otherwise we would not know about you?
Well, the first is that I don't bite, and I sure wish we could recruit new members to the choir. I know in these times it's going to be difficult, but I want them to know they're always welcome. We have a wonderful group of singers here. My pride and joy, which anybody in the choir knows, is my son. I was 46 years old when I had my first child, and he just graduated from Grand Canyon, so he's stuck in quarantine with us now. And very few people know I won 2 Grammys. I don't have the statues like all these people on TV when you see their bookshelves with their Emmys, but I am on 2 recordings with the Chicago Symphony. I was in the chorus, and of course they don't give statues to the 200-plus chorus people, but I could say I'm on the recordings anyway.
That's great. And your son who just graduated, what is he looking to do?
He wants to be a doctor.
So he'll be applying for med schools then?
Yes, he's studying for the MCAT. Now he's going to take that in September.
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
Please join your heart with me in prayer. Lord, thank you for Bill. Thank you for the work he does with the choir. I really appreciate him since I'm in the choir, for his encouragement for all of us, his patience with people like me who are not at all trained singers. I pray for his son. Help him as he prepares for the MCAT. Give him a sharpness of mind, and pray that you'd help him to get into a good med school and prepare well for the career that is ahead of him. We are concerned, Lord. We are in the midst of a pandemic, and we are tired of being sheltered at home. We are tired of not being able to see people we want to see. We are tired of not being able to be encouraged by one another and to encourage one another. We get weary and worn down, and we pray that you would give us the perseverance, the stamina, to hang in there, to do the things that are wise and safe, even if we're tired of that. We pray for medical researchers that you would grant them insights to come up with good ways of treating this and to come up with a vaccine. We pray for all who are working in the midst of this situation. We pray for doctors, nurses, therapists, EMT. We pray for all maintenance, everybody who works in hospitals. We pray that you would sustain them, keep them safe, watch over them as they're getting worn out as well. We're also in the midst of some very turbulent times in our country, and we pray that you would help us as we are dealing with social issues, issues that pertain to matters of liberty and justice for all. We pray for our elected and appointed leaders as they face these tough issues. Give them integrity, wisdom, courage, and good conscience as they tackle these matters, to truly do it in a way that will lead to liberty and justice for all. And Lord, we pray for one of our sister churches. We pray for West Valley Christian Fellowship. We pray for the ministries, the people of that church. Care for them, bless them, enrich them, use them. And we pray for one of the missions that we support. We pray for Heart Pantry. We pray that you would supply all that they need, bless them, and bless the kids that they minister to. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Please sing together with us. And I love how Gary had said that earlier. You can sing as loudly as you want, because nobody else, and even off key, because no one else will hear you. But let's sing together, all creatures of our God and King.
Reading from the letters this morning is Romans 12, 9 to 21. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer, contribute to the needs of the saints, extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice, and weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another, do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourself, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not become do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Our prayer for illumination this morning, may God speak to each of us this morning. Let us hear his word, understand his word, and this week spread that word.
We have the joy this morning. We got to interview Bill earlier, and now we get some special music from Bill along with Beth Mabee. We have been racing through the Gospel of John, stopping and taking a look at his conversations with people, his miracles, those personal encounters. Today, we're continuing that rush through John, and we're in chapter 13, the account of Jesus washing the feet. We're going to look at verse 1 through verse 15, and this is what John records. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart this earth and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet and to wipe them with a towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I'm doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash, but is entirely clean. And you, though not all of you, for he knew who was to betray him. For this reason, he said, not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you should do as I have done to you." This is the word of the Lord. Over and over again, throughout each day, we face a critical question. Will I follow the values and the ways of this world? Or will I follow the values and the ways of Jesus Christ? Almost 50 years ago, Robert J. Ringer wrote a best-selling book that continues to reflect the mindset of modern American culture. The book, Winning Through Intimidation, grew out of his own experience. Ringer shares, "I did one altruistic good deed after another, concentrating on the other person's best interest, naively believing that my good deed would be appreciated and that I'd be commensurately rewarded. At best, I ended up with a handful of air. At worst, I got a slap in the face." He gave up on altruism and chose a more aggressive approach to life. He states, "From now on, I would have to be the intimidator and maneuver others into the role of intimidatee. For the first time, I had experienced the thrill of winning through intimidation. There was no longer the slightest doubt in my mind that intimidation was the key to winning." J.B. Phillips suggests that our world tends to operate by a different set of beatitudes than those that are presented to us in Matthew chapter 5. "Happy are the pushers, for they get on in the world. Happy are the hard-boiled, for they never let life hurt them. Happy are they who complain, for they get their own way in the end. Happy are the blasé, for they never worry about their sins. Happy are the slave drivers, for they get results. Happy are the knowledgeable of the world, for they know their way around. Happy are the troublemakers, for they make people take notice of them. But the values and the ways of Jesus Christ? During supper, the night before he was crucified, after the disciples had been engaged in an argument over which of them is the greatest, Jesus gets up from the table, takes off his outer robe, and ties a towel around himself. Then he pours water into a basin and begins to wash the feet of his disciples, drying them with the towel that is tied around him. When he comes to Simon Peter, Peter balks at the idea of Jesus washing his feet. My guess is that during that argument over who was the greatest, Peter may have said something to one of the lesser disciples, insinuating that that particular disciple was not fit to wash Peter's feet. That's my guess. So when Jesus comes around to wash Peter's feet, Peter's aghast at that. In that culture, the idea of one person washing another person's feet was a clear demarcation of one person's superiority over the other person. Peter is fine with arguing about himself being the greatest among those disciples. But for Jesus to put himself in a position of lowering himself to washing Peter's feet, Peter doesn't know what to do with that. Finally, though, he allows Jesus to wash his feet when Jesus stresses that unless he washes Peter, Peter can have no share with him. After washing their feet, Jesus returns to the table and he says to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you're right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you should do as I have done to you." In washing the feet of the disciples, Jesus reveals a different approach to life than winning through intimidation. He revealed an approach of love and of service. Rather than maneuvering others into a position of being beneath him, Jesus served others by washing their feet. M. Scott Peck comments, "Until that moment, the whole point of things had been for someone to get on top, and once he had gotten on top, to stay on top, or else to attempt to get farther up. But here, this man already on top, who was rabbi, teacher, master, suddenly got down on the bottom and began to wash the feet of his followers. In that one act, Jesus symbolically overturned the whole social order. Hardly comprehending what was happening, even his own disciples were almost horrified by his behavior. In his book, Lessons from a Sheepdog, Philip Keller describes the deeper understanding of God's love that he gained while caring for a troubled border collie whom he had adopted. He writes, "For the first few weeks, Lass was like a highly strung musical instrument. The lightest touch of my hands upon her made her tremble with tension. So long had she been out of tune with life that it took the new master's knowing hands a considerable time to bring her into harmony with himself. In her subconscious mind lingered the dark shadows of the abuse she had suffered in the wrong hands. But when I brushed her thick, lustrous coat, it seemed to set her apprehension at ease. When I carefully removed the burrs from her body, she sensed with her acute intelligence that I truly cared about her. She even learned to let me pull the angry wild rose thorns from between her toes. When the burning ceased, she would lick my hand in gratitude. In all of these intimate contacts, I began to discern that I was as much her servant as she was mine. God's gentle spirit showed me in vivid reality the enormous condescension of Christ, who in love and self-humiliation tends my human needs. Keller captures correctly what Jesus revealed to us in John 13. With the self-humiliation of washing the feet of his disciples, Jesus reveals an approach to life that is driven by the depth of God's love for us. In calling us to follow his example, Jesus sets before us that critical question. Will I follow the values and the ways of this world, or will I follow the values and the ways of Jesus Christ? Jesus set for us an example of loving and serving unconditionally. If it had been up to me to wash the feet of those disciples, I would have had great trouble with washing their feet unconditionally. I would have been inclined to put in some digs when I came to the different disciples. When I came to Peter, who would soon deny Jesus, I would have been inclined to say, "Peter, are these your feet? I hardly recognize them." When I came to Thomas, I would have been inclined to ask, to say, "Thomas, I doubt that this washing will get all the dirt off of your feet." And when I came to Judas, I would have been inclined to twist his ankle rather than to wash his feet. But Jesus loved them unconditionally, not on the basis of what they had done, or what they were about to do, or on the basis of what they deserved, but on the basis of the fullness of God's love for them, for us. When the love within us is limited, it cannot compensate for the faults and flaws of others. And so we have trouble loving unconditionally. But the love within Jesus was great enough that he could love beyond their faults and flaws. He could love them unconditionally. Are we able to tap deeply enough into Jesus' deep love to be able to love others without conditions? Jesus set for us an example of loving and serving sacrificially. Jesus left his meal. He took off his robe. He got down on his knees. He humbled himself. Shortly after this, he would give his very life on the cross. What are we willing to give up for the sake of caring for another? How far are we willing to humble ourselves for the sake of caring for someone else? Jesus set for us an example of loving and serving actively. Jesus did not simply wish his disciples well. He got up from the table. He poured water into a basin. He washed their feet. He dried them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He took action to meet their needs. James 1:15-16 states, "If a brother or sister is naked and lacks food, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill,' and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that?" Are we willing to get up, to get involved, to lend a hand, to do something practical? Russian author Leo Tolstoy shares the story of a cobbler named Martin. Martin was a lonely and grumpy man, but a neighbor had convinced him to read the Bible. Late one night, Martin read in the Bible the story about the Pharisee who had given Jesus a very cold reception. And as Martin went to bed that night, he wondered to himself, "If the Lord came to me, would I behave like that?" He fell asleep with that question on his mind. And as he slept, he heard the Lord speak to him. "Martin, look out into the street tomorrow, for I shall come to you." Martin awoke full of excitement, certain that the Lord would come to him that day. And Martin was determined to give the Lord a better reception than the Pharisee had given to Jesus. As he went about his work mending boots, he kept looking out the window, anticipating Jesus coming to his doorway. At one point, as he looked out, he saw someone at the doorway, but it was not Jesus. It was an old man who had huddled in that doorway, trying to keep himself warm. Martin thought at first about going and chasing him away so he would not be in the way when the Lord came, but uncharacteristically, moved by pity, Martin went to the door and invited the man in to come in and warm himself. And he gave to that man the warm drink that he had prepared that morning for Christ, when Christ would arrive. The man drank, the man warmed himself, and then the man left. And Martin went back to his work and kept looking out the door, waiting for Jesus to arrive, and he saw somebody else there. He saw a woman poorly dressed with a baby in her arms. It was obvious that both of them were hungry and cold. Martin called them in, and he shared with them the bread and the soup that he had prepared for Jesus. And then he gave her some money so she could buy herself a shawl to help cover her and her child. Later in the day, he saw one more person, a young boy who was hungry. And again, Martin invited him in and cared for that young boy. At last, the day ended, and Martin's heart sank, for the Lord had not come to his house. In deep sorrow, Martin picked up his Bible again, and it fell open to the parable in Matthew 25, where the king says, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Martin understood that the Savior had truly come to his house that day, and that Martin had welcomed him as he should have. In calling us to follow his example, Jesus sets before us this critical question: will we follow the values and the ways of this world, or will we follow the values and the ways of Jesus Christ. Please join with me in prayer. Jesus, thank you for washing the feet of the disciples. Thank you for coming to visit Martin. And though Martin's story is made up, you do come in those ways. In the poor, in the needy, whom we meet. And we have the chance to love you by loving others. Lord, help us to follow your example. Help us to live by the values and the ways of our Savior, rather than by the values and the ways of this world. We need your help to do that because we love conditionally, and we cannot do these things unless we are filled with your love. Fill us, Lord, so that we can love as you would love through us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And I invite you to join us in singing together, God be with you, God be with you till we meet again. As our benediction, let me share with you the words of Micah 6:8. God has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God? May God help us to live that way this week. Amen.